Well, good evening, everybody. This is Paul Perkin speaking, and I'm absolutely delighted to be with you this evening. Just to make sure that you can hear me, just wave a hand if you're with me. Oh, that's wonderful. And it's extra wonderful to be making contact again with the congregation and the friends of the congregation of St. Peter's Chateau. Some of you, of course, I know very well indeed from numerous visits to Chateau and to St. Peter's. Some of you I know by sight from having joined in with you in various things and even from having spoken and led a Bible study or two and some services at Chateau. And some of you are strangers to me, but it's absolutely wonderful to be with all of you. I'm leading the service from UK, just south of London in the Surrey Hills. I'm looking out of my study window over the Weald of Kent where the sun is shining over to the far distance, 30 miles away, I can see the South Downs. And beyond that, presumably, is the English Channel. So it's lovely here, but I bet it's even more wonderful and brilliant sunshine in Chateau. I'm imagining myself being with you. So thank you for inviting me. I'm going to be helping to lead your service and to speak to it, to give the talk on one or two of the Sundays over the next month. And it's a great pleasure to do so. But let's be quiet now before the service begins. And let's spend a moment to focus on our lives, on the God who loves us, who loved us enough to come and die for us and to rise again. We're continuing to celebrate the Easter resurrection and to bring ourselves, our needs, and the needs of the world to him. Will you join in with me with the words in bold, as I think you're used to doing? I will lead the rest of the words. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you. May God arise, and let his enemies be scattered. Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Blessed are you, sovereign Lord, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. To you be glory and praise forever. From the deep waters of death, you brought your people to new birth by raising your Son to life in triumph. Through him, dark death has been destroyed, and radiant life is everywhere restored. As you call us out of darkness into his marvelous light, may our lives reflect his glory and our lips repeat the endless song. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. Well, we begin with our first hymn, a wonderful hymn, In Christ Alone, My Hope Is Found.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift
What tremendous words for us to stand on and to rely on, that Christ died and rose again, bursting forth from the grave to declare his forgiveness and his life to us. And that gives us all the more courage and confidence to come to him in confession, and if there's anything recently on our consciences, to ask his cleansing and forgiveness. Let's just spend a moment asking him to expose to ourselves, our minds, our hearts, our motives, our words and thoughts and actions. And whatever we've come to mind in person and private, individually, let's bring together with a joint confession as we confess together. Lord our God, in our sin we have avoided your call. Our love for you is like a morning cloud, like the dew that goes away early. Have mercy on us. Deliver us from judgment. Bind up our wounds and revive us. In Jesus Christ our Lord. And the Bible reassures us, the words of Christ and the apostles reassure us, that the God of love and power forgives us and frees us from our sins and is pledged to heal and strengthen us by his Spirit and to raise us to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. Our psalm for this evening is Psalm 116. And in each verse, there are words which I will read, and will you join with me in the responses in bold? The psalmist says, "I love the Lord, for he has heard the voice of my supplication, because he inclined his ear to me on the day I called to him. The snares of death encompassed me, the pains of hell took hold of me. By grief and sorrow was I held. Then I called upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, I beg you, deliver my soul. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Our God is full of compassion. The Lord watches over the simple. I was brought very low, and he saved me. Turn again to your rest, O my soul, for the Lord has been gracious to you. For you have delivered my soul from death, my eyes from tears, and my feet from falling." And now John chapter 20, verses 19 to 31, are going to be read for us, I think read again for us, as Jesus appears to his disciples and especially to Thomas.
So today's reading will be from John 20, verses 19 to 31. Is it supposed to be on the screen? Oh, okay. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Jesus appears to Thomas. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands, reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. Well, friends, I think you had this reading last week. But it bears very much, it bears worth looking at again. And so this is, if you like, John chapter 20, part two. Let me pray before we look at it further. Lord Jesus, as you spoke to the disciples in your risen presence, as you spoke through John, recording this in his gospel, will you also speak to us by your Holy Spirit now and for your glory's sake? Amen. Well, if you've been reading through the Easter story and the resurrection appearances of Jesus, it's very striking. I don't know if you noticed this, that John, as he records the different resurrection appearances, each appearance answers one of our traumas concerning death. The resurrection appearance to Mary answers our grief. The appearance to the disciples answers our fear. Peace be with you, peace be with you, peace be with you. Three times he says to them in the upper room. The resurrection appearance to Peter answers our failure and guilt. And the resurrection appearance to Thomas answers our doubt. Put all those together, and hasn't John wonderfully recorded the solutions to our fears? Now, let me ask the question, why was Thomas not with them that first Sunday evening when Jesus came? I think the answer is in his character. What kind of a man was he? He was a man of a literal mind and a loyal heart. A literal mind, when Jesus talked about going to heaven, do you remember in chapter 14, Thomas had said, well, I don't know about this. How do we get there? Bring it to earth for me. Tell me the way. That's Thomas. A literal mind. He wanted everything simple and plain, down to earth. He also had a loyal heart. In chapter 11 of John's Gospel, we read that when Jesus turned towards Jerusalem, Thomas said, well, if he's really determined to die, we might as well all go with him and die with him. So loyal was he. And a literal mind and a loyal heart are a very attractive combination. But it's a temperament that finds it difficult to share its burdens. Thomas would go away by himself, as we might do. He would brood. He wouldn't want to be troubled by people. Now, let me think this out for myself. So on that first Sunday evening, Thomas was by himself brooding, maybe walking the streets of Jerusalem, and he wasn't there. He was all alone, and he missed it all. This is just the reminder to us that you can miss out seriously, badly, by not being with the followers of Jesus at the right time, especially if we're brooding on a problem. And that's true whether we're a Christian, committed to the church fellowship, or on the fringe and the edge of it. Help is among God's people. But as it was, Thomas spent another week in misery and loneliness and doubt because he wasn't in the place where there was blessing. And so I thank God for the opportunities that we have to actually meet together in person. And let's not despise those or take them for granted, take them lightly. And what a boon and a blessing Zoom services have been when we can't meet physically, but we can still, nevertheless, by his Spirit, encourage one another. How important that is. Now, let's look at Thomas's doubt. I think I can understand it. The death of Jesus had dealt such a crushing blow, and everyone else kept saying, we've seen the Lord. And his mind couldn't cope. I just cannot accept it. I'm sorry, clearly you think you have seen him. He said, I've got to have evidence. It's not enough to hear from you that Christ is alive. I don't trust my ears. It's not even enough to see the Lord. I wouldn't even trust my eyes. I think he's implying that people can have hallucinations. By the way, doesn't this have the ring of truth about it? If you or I had made this all up, no one would have invented an account of one disciple suggesting that the others were just seeing things. So Thomas says, seeing is not enough. I've got to push my fingers right into the holes in his hands and the wounds in his side before I'll believe. Now, Thomas is often called Doubting Thomas. I think we run him down too much. Here are four good things about his doubt. First, he was honest. He didn't believe, he couldn't believe, and he said so. And I thank God, don't you, for such honesty. Second, he was reasonable. He demanded evidence. I know you thought about that last week in your service. And that's a reasonable thing to do. And Christianity stands to reason. Thirdly, he was a discerning person. He saw that the physical resurrection of Jesus was vital, or else it was nothing. Either Jesus had risen with a body, or he was still dead. None of this talk about the ideals of Christianity living on. You know, as people might say, Che Guevara lives, or the spirit of Marx lives, or Lenin lives on, or the spirit of Elvis Presley lives on. No, either Jesus was dead, in which case Christianity collapses like a house of cards. Or Jesus was and is alive. And the consequences of that were mind-blowing. And Thomas couldn't cope with it, but he was a discerning person. And fourthly, he was sincere. He says, I could never believe unless that happens, but the sequel shows that he is prepared to believe. And underneath he's saying, I'd love to believe, but he couldn't. And I don't know if you come across, I come across people who are saying, I can't believe or I don't believe. But underneath they're saying, I'd love to believe. And that puts the onus on us to help them find the good grounds for believing, to share our testimonies, to share the gospel story. Now, 1 week later, it's the same time, the same place, behind the same locked door, and the same people were there, with one exception, or rather, one addition. Thomas is now also there. It almost seems like a repetition. And the same thing happens this Sunday evening. Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace. And then said to Thomas, here's your chance, Thomas. Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. Now, do you see there? Jesus showed that he had been listening to what Thomas had said. He'd been in the room all the time, invisible to them. The other disciples didn't say to Jesus when he appeared, do you know what Thomas said last Sunday? They'd never told him. And you see, this is to some people a frightening thing, but you know, to us a wonderful and glorious thing. Jesus is listening now to what you and I are saying and even to what we're thinking. Look at the patience and the understanding and the tenderness of Jesus. Thomas, I know about all your doubts. All right, if that's the only way to find faith, come. But I must have believing disciples. Come on. And the most wonderful thing is, now this is an argument from silence, but it certainly doesn't say that he did that. The most wonderful thing is perhaps Thomas never did. He never did put his hands in his side or his fingers in the scars of Jesus's hands. There's no record of him touching Christ. Instead, like a flash of lightning, he saw the truth. Instead of lagging behind the other 10, he dashed past them. And Thomas was the first man ever in human history to say to Jesus, to his face, God, without any qualification whatsoever. My Lord and my God. You know, for a Jew to say that is a miracle. A Jew is taught from the earliest days that there was only one God and he's in heaven. And for a Jew to say, my God, to a human being was a miracle. And then Thomas said something rather sad. Jesus said something rather sad. He said, Thomas, I'm glad you came to believe, but I'm sad about the way you came to it. I wish you'd come another way. I wish you'd believed what you'd heard, because that's how everybody else is going to have to believe. Thomas, you'd be a happier man if you'd believed what you'd heard. And you've been unhappy and ashamed for a week because of it. Happy are those, he says, who have not seen and yet believe the testimony that the Lord is alive. Now, that is very good news for us. It means that every one of us can be happier today than Thomas was on that Sunday evening. Does that encourage and excite you? It ought to. You can be happier. And if we put our trust in the Lord, we hear in the gospel from the reliable account of faithful men and women to events that they had witnessed. If we do that, we can enjoy the living Lord now. And one day we will see him. And we will be happier because we believed him first. Happy are those who have not seen and yet believed. And with those words, John has reached the climax of his gospel. He's got to where he wants to be. He's come full circle. Do you remember right at the beginning, he began with the statement, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word became a human being. Now he's come to the point where one other man has seen that this human being is God. And that's what he wrote for. The centurion had just got there almost before him. Truly, this man was the Son of God. But then Thomas simply says, God. And you can imagine the old man John pausing with his pen in his hand, I don't know what it was, a stylus over his papyrus, glancing at what he'd written. And suddenly it strikes him how much he's missed out, how many things he could have written and hasn't. And it hits him. There are many things, mighty works Jesus did, which are not written in this book. But the important thing is that John, realizing all that he's missed out, comes to the conclusion, nevertheless, I've said enough. I could have written loads of other incidents, but I've written enough. I've come to the point where a man says to Jesus, my Lord and my God. And I've written enough so that you readers, he's writing probably around late 60s AD, you readers and us today can say it too. I've written that so that you may do two things. Number one, believe. Number two, live. Number one, believe. Believe that a man called Jesus, 2,000 years ago, thousands of miles away, that man Jesus was not only the fulfillment of a Jewish hope of 1,000 years, a Messiah, but that he's God's only son. And anyone who reads John's gospel can come to believe he is just that. But notice, you've got to put the personal pronoun in. It's not enough to say, as the centurion did, truly this man is the Son of God. You've got to add the word my. My Lord, my God. And as soon as you put the my in the believing, it changes it into living. Believing, you have life in his name, real life, abundant life, life really worth living. Now, the astute of you will see that actually, even that now isn't the end of John's gospel. It's as if he wakes up the next day, and we'll come to this possibly next week or the week after in our services. It's as if he then wakes up the next day and he says, oh, but I must put something else in. And the reason, we'll come to this, the reason is that John is writing, as I say, probably in the 60s, when Peter, the first leader of the church, the rock on whom the church was built, has been killed. And if tradition is right, though it's not directly in the Gospels, I think it's implied here, he was crucified as Jesus was. And the rumor was spreading. Was Peter, in fact, the rock on the church? How could he have been if he's been snuffed out? He's been taken away from us. He denied Jesus. Was he really forgiven? Is his accounts, which incidentally are written up in Mark's gospel, is his account reliable? Is Peter the one? And so John adds chapter 21, in which he says, yes, Peter was restored. Peter was forgiven. And Jesus knew the way in which Peter himself would die as he did. His arms would be stretched out and men would take him where he did not wish to go, that is to the cross. Well, we'll come to that. But let me end with two final things about Thomas. The first is this. As I said, we call him Doubting Thomas, Thomas the Doubter. But of course, in the Gospels, he's not given that nickname, nowhere in the New Testament. But he does have another name, Thomas the Twin. Thomas, also called Didymus, Greek for twin. You know, we have absolutely no knowledge about his twin. Have you ever wondered, was it a boy or a girl? He or she quite possibly was not a Christian believer. Indeed, I would dare to suggest was probably not. Or that twin might have been named or recurred at some point in the Acts of the Apostles. It tells us this serious truth. Two people can be as close as twins, but one is a Christian and the other is not. Two people shared the same womb at the same time at their birth, but have different eternal destinies from their death. And the second thought is this. Both Sunday evenings, the disciples were together with the doors locked out of fear. They were afraid of the crucifixion. The previous week, there had been 13 of them, 12 plus Jesus. Then there were only 10 of them. They must have wondered who was next to go. And they were afraid of the tomb, the rumor spreading that the disciples had stolen the body, waiting for the Jews to come and get them. They were scared stiff, and the doors were bolted, and I imagine all the furniture was up against the door. Now, the point is this. Doors might keep the Jews out, but they couldn't keep Jesus out. One thing you can never do is shut Jesus out of your life, at least not forever. You can try, but you and I haven't the capacity to do it. You see, Jesus doesn't always stand at the door and knock. You know that famous and wonderful verse in the book of Revelation, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door to me, I will come into their life." But Jesus doesn't always stand at the door and knock. Sometimes he walks through it. He can do that. He can step right into your life and mine. We may have cut ourselves right off from other people, but Jesus can step right in. But we don't need to be afraid of Jesus when he comes. We don't need to be afraid of a Lord who comes unexpectedly because his first word is shalom, peace. Fear leads you to withdraw, to close your doors, to shut other people out. The disciples were doing it physically. We can do it mentally, emotionally. Like Thomas, don't come near me. I want to hide away. I want to be by myself. I want to work this out by myself. But Jesus didn't leave him in that state. He didn't leave him afraid. He stepped in and he said as much to Thomas, maybe even more to Thomas, as to the others who had already heard the message. Peace be with you. You can stop wondering. And he said it on two successive Sunday evenings. And I don't know what kind of state you've come to this service this evening, but it may be that it's the same for you this evening, that this is a moment to say to the Lord Jesus, I receive your peace. If I've been hiding from you in any way, ignoring you, hiding from other people, maybe by force because of the isolation of this COVID restriction, thank you. I welcome you. Thank you. I make you my Lord and my God again today. Maybe in the quiet, in the silence, echo that in your own thought, in your own heart, in your own words. Say to him, some of us have known Jesus Christ as Lord and God, as rescuer of our lives, as the forgiver of our lives for many, many years, but it's a time to say again, Jesus, you are my Lord, my God. And maybe for some of us, this is a renewed moment after a period, maybe even a long period, of hiding away. Or maybe for the first time, you've just zoomed in on this service by invitation and you're just here watching, as it were, observing from the sidelines. Don't just stay isolated and independent, thinking it through by yourself. Work it out with God's people, and when you can, join with them. And say to him in your own heart, Lord, I determine to follow you and to do so amongst your disciples for your glory's sake. Amen. So I encourage us all, and maybe with extra conviction and joy, to confess the faith that we can confess, that we can proclaim ourselves today. And so we say together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And so let us pray for the church and for the world, and let us thank God for his goodness. And first, personally, we thank you, Lord Jesus Christ, for your resurrection presence and power by your Spirit with us today. And whether we are in a family or alone, whether we are in the Church of St. Peter's today, or zooming in from across the world, as I am doing from the UK, thank you that you are with us. Thank you that we have reasonable and solid evidence on which to ground our faith. Thank you that you love honesty. Maybe some of us echo that prayer, I believe, help thou my unbelief. And we thank you for preserving us. Thank you for keeping us through this COVID lockdown. And we rejoice at the anticipation of release. And we know that in different countries, this is taking place at different rates. We thank you for the gradual and encouraging release from limitations here in the UK. And we pray that across Europe and across the world, we may soon be out of these restrictions. Thank you for the gift of science and the gift of COVID vaccinations. We pray that these may be multiplied and provided throughout the world. We pray especially for the developing world, who for understandable but wrong reasons are catching up slowly behind the developed world. So we pray not just for ourselves, our families, our communities, or even our nation or our continent. We pray that you would save and rescue our world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Here in the UK, many of us were watching the funeral service of Prince Philip, the Duke of Edinburgh, yesterday. And we thanked God for him and for the faithful determination and resolve of his life over 99 years. And that, I suspect, means that every single one of us here that's joining today, he's been a part of our history for every day of all of our lives. We pray today for Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II and for the royal family. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that you would comfort Elizabeth, our Queen, and lead her to trust in you increasingly with joy and assurance in the Lord of her own resurrection. Increase her confidence and faith and comfort her. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we thank you, Heavenly Father, for the congregation of St. Peter's, both in Chateau, but with its reach right across Europe and beyond. And we thank you for this wonderful fellowship of multifaceted, different believers from different nations and languages, and yet brought together in this fellowship. And we pray that you would have your blessing upon St. Peter's. We thank you for Clive and his wonderful, blessed ministry over the years, and pray for his successor, that that person may be a godly, believing, praying, faithful pastor who will teach the word, pray for the flock, feed the sheep, and reach out to those who do not yet believe. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. And we bring our prayers together, first with the collect, the special prayer for today. Risen Christ, you filled your disciples with boldness and fresh hope. Strengthen us to proclaim your risen life and fill us with your peace, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. And as Jesus taught us, gathering our prayers into one, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Well, friends, I think I'm going to hand over to Donato. Donato, I probably cut you out from giving an introduction at the beginning.
Well, you were faster than me. I was welcoming somebody coming in that has never been to St. Peter, so I had a good excuse.
Well, if it was anyway, an introduction...
Thanks very much, Paul. And we miss you on the slope this year. Flying Paul wasn't around. I hope we'll be best next year. Anyway, as Paul just said, you know, this kind of service will go on for another while. But don't worry, the council in Vevey and Chateau de St. Peter are working to try to find a new pastor. We don't know when it will be coming, but in between we have people like Paul and Chris Jarvis last week that will bring us the word of God without any problem. Thank you, Paul. I hope your family is all right, Christine and Jules, everything all right?
They're all very well. And if I cut out your introduction, it was only about me, then you're probably much better off for it.
Anyway, next thing is, next Wednesday, we're looking forward to see Paul again at 6 o'clock for a Bible study. And as Paul said at the beginning, you know, this is the second time that this passage has been read and preached. But I think there were a lot of questions and lots of things left behind that we can ask him on Wednesday at 6 o'clock Swiss time, 5 o'clock English time. And let's all be like little Thomas and bring out our questions. Next thing is, we would like to start again with the gathering at Notre Dame. And I was thinking, because this coming week is not going to be very nice, but the 29th of April, which will be the following Thursday, not this coming one, we will gather at 5 o'clock at Marilyn's and Bob Chalet, like we did last year. Whoever is free is welcome to come, and there'll be something to eat, maybe something to drink. Sometimes water turns into wine as well. You never know. So everything is possible and everybody is welcome. The other thing that we'll try to organize is on the 6th of May, which it is a Thursday as well. I was thinking that it would be nice if we could have a little walk to get, the cobweb, the winter cobweb way. Just a little walk, an hour go and an hour come back. And if that will suit you, we'll give you more information probably next Sunday and the Sunday after. Well, that's it. I'm going to leave it back to you, Paul. Thanks for everything. Bye.
Thank you, Donato.
I have one little point. I think everyone's had the newsletter, but Paul is preaching next Sunday, and you should have had the details on your newsletter. And then he'll be taking the Bible study the following Wednesday as well.
Thank you, Marilyn, and thank you, Donato. And Christine, in the background, is sending her love as well to you all. So may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father who created, the Son who died and rose again for us, the Holy Spirit who lives within us, be with us this day and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
And so the hymn, as we close, King of Kings, Lord of Lords.
Before you now, in royal robes, I
Well, thank you all very much for joining us. And it's been a great delight myself to see a number of faces that I know and to pick up with you all this evening. Is it this evening now? Of course, we're an hour behind you. It's still only sort of tea time here in England. But it's been lovely and look forward to seeing any of you who'd like to join us on Wednesday as well.